Three, two, one.
The Committee on Foreign Affairs will come to order.
Without objection,
the chair is authorized to declare recess of the committee
at any point.
And all members will have five days to submit statements,
extraneous material,
questions for the record.
Subject to the limitations in the rules.
To insert something into the record,
please have your email, the previously mentioned address,
or contact full committee staff.
As a reminder to members,
please keep your video phone on at all times.
Even when you're not recognized by the chair.
Members are responsible for muting and unmuting themselves.
Consistent with House rules,
staff will only mute members as appropriate when they are not under recognition to eliminate background noise. I see that we have a quorum, and I now recognize myself for opening remarks. Let me say good morning to everyone and welcome Special Envoy John Kerry to today's committee hearing entitled Driving a Global Response to Climate Action. Last month's Leaders Summit on Climate, the first summit for the Biden administration, was another strong signal to the world that the U.S. is back after years of costly absence. And the stakes could not be higher. Although the threats sometimes seem distant, we cannot turn back the clock. This is especially true of climate change, where we have lost precious time in responding to a mounting crisis. Even if we achieve our ambitious goal of keeping 1.5% warming within reach, our children will still have to learn to live on a dramatically changed planet. Many will have to move from uninhabitable land, if they can. Others, who are not so lucky, must endure more frequent and severe weather events, fires, drought, and pollution, which have become the new perilous norm. But yet, I remain an optimist. The Biden administration committed to drastically reduce U.S. emissions by 2030. Now, certainly this is ambitious, but ambition is what we need right now. We welcome the British pledge to ban non-electric vehicles by 2030, which sparked similar plans in at least 16 other countries and several U.S. states. And on the global level, we saw China set long-needed targets on coal, Brazil pledged to end deforestation by 2030, Argentina and others committed to deploy more renewables. Japan, South Korea, and Canada made more ambitious pledges than those in Paris. Now, as a believer in the science behind climate change, as well as the benefits of trade, investment, and American ingenuity in the face of competition, what I see is opportunity. A well-defined plan on climate action will create high-paying, good jobs for the American people. And our committee will play its crucial role in getting us there. We are exploring legislative options that will support innovative approaches with civil society and the private sector. And as chair, I fully support efforts to galvanize climate action in the lead up to the Glasgow and beyond. It's not just about summit diplomacy and commitments on paper, it's about paving the road to Glasgow and follow through beyond. There remain obvious hurdles in achieving the necessary collective action, however. Yes, we have worked with strategic competitors like China and Russia, but we also have to hold them accountable. And yes, they will require investment in developing countries. And yes, it will involve helping our neighbors, as good neighbors do. What do we do as leaders on the global stage to tackle this problem? We work strategically with other ambitious countries to spark the momentum leading up to Glasgow. This includes the G7 and the G20, which shows the multilateral approach has us moving in the right direction. We must also empower the U.S. government, including through the International Development Finance Corporation, to have global reach assisting all countries, including all those in the Caribbean, Eastern Europe, and Africa, to have access to needed financing and investment opportunities. When it comes to building a green, resilient economy, adapting and protecting one's people, countries should not be left with only China as an option, whose investments often come with strings attached. Financing options should not be based solely on income criteria, but on vulnerability and risk to external shocks. In the years since, we've survived the hottest years on record and emitted the highest levels of carbon in human history. The gap of what is being done and what needs to be done has also grown. And I think of the words of John F. Kennedy Jr., who said, "Every accomplishment starts with a decision to try." So I pledge not only to try as the chairman of this committee, but demand that we do our best to save this planet. With that, I'll turn to my good friend and the ranking member of this committee, Mr. McCall, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding today's hearing. And I want to welcome you, Secretary Kerry, back to the Hill. It's good to see you. I believe the climate is changing, and we must take steps to address it. However, the answer is not the Paris Agreement in its current form. The People's Republic of China is the world's leading greenhouse gas emitter and is responsible for almost 30% of global emissions. Yet the Paris Agreement does the bare minimum to hold the PRC accountable while allowing them to continue increasing their emissions until 2030. At the same time, it disproportionately penalizes American workers and American industries, even though the PRC emits over twice as much carbon dioxide as the United States. And Mr. Secretary, I understand you've got a big challenge ahead of you, and we had a good visit on this issue. But I just don't see how we can truly make an impact if China isn't held to the same standards as the United States. Last year alone, the Chinese Communist Party brought more than three times as many new coal-powered plants online in the PRC as the rest of the world combined. And they aren't just polluting at home. Beijing is exporting coal-fired power plants throughout the developing world through their Belt and Road Initiative. In fact, the CCP is the biggest financier of coal plants in the world. It's clear the Chinese Communist Party doesn't care about the environment. They have proven time and again they cannot be trusted and are not a reliable partner in addressing climate change. That's why I've worked with Representatives Graves and McMorris Rodgers to introduce the Paris Transparency and Accountability Act. Our bill acknowledges that it's vital we renegotiate the Paris Agreement to create a level playing field, and it calls for this new agreement to be submitted for Senate approval. Any comprehensive agreement that will significantly impact American jobs and the American economy deserves that much. Our bill would also ensure there's sufficient oversight of the committees and commitments the president makes on behalf of the American people under the agreement, and it makes certain those commitments don't jeopardize our national security or our competitiveness. Like you, Secretary Kerry, I'm a father, and I care about the world we are leaving behind for our children and our grandchildren, and we have that in common. Yet after the United States finally achieved energy independence in oil and natural gas, we now appear to be tying our future energy needs to the CCP dominated supply chains, such as solar panels and electric batteries. If we truly want to reduce emissions, we must keep all these options on the table. That also means investing in renewable energy, but it also means expanding our nuclear energy capabilities, including, as you and I talked about, the development of small modular reactors with zero carbon emissions. And it means utilizing fossil fuels with a smaller environmental impact. For example, LNG from my home state of Texas has significantly lower life cycle emissions than coal or Russian piped gas. The United States has been a leader in addressing climate risk through innovation and technology. Now more than ever, we need to take advantage of our strengths, which have enabled us to become energy independent. So, Secretary Kerry, I look forward to hearing your thoughts on what steps can be taken to address climate risks in a responsible way that also protects American interest and jobs. And before I close, I and many of my colleagues are concerned by alleged conversations that you have purportedly had with Iranian Foreign Minister Zarif after you were Secretary of State. Iran is the world's largest state sponsor of terror and one of our biggest adversaries. I hope you will address these allegations today before Congress, and I hope you'll reassure this committee that classified or sensitive information was not shared with Iranian officials when you were either Secretary of State or after you left your post. Again, thank you for being here today, and Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. McCall. Now I'll introduce our witness. On January 20th, 2021, John F. Kerry was sworn in as the nation's first special presidential envoy for climate, where he leads the United States' international efforts to address climate change. In recent years, Special Envoy Kerry was the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace's first ever visiting distinguished statesman, following his 4 years as the 68th United States Secretary of the State. In that capacity, he was a critical part of the successful negotiations in the peace in the Paris Climate Agreement. From 1985 to 2013, he served as a United States Senator representing Massachusetts and was the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee from 2009 to 2013. Secretary Kerry served in the United States Navy, completing two combat tours of duty in Vietnam, for which he received a Silver Star, a Bronze Star, and with Combat 5, and three Purple Hearts. He received his undergraduate degree from Yale University and his law degree from Boston College Law School. Most importantly, he's an American patriot, a patriot and a close friend of mine. And I welcome Secretary John Kerry. So without objection, the witness's prepared testimony will be made part of the record, and I now recognize the Honorable John Kerry.
Well, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member McCall, distinguished members of the committee, it's a great privilege for me to be able to be here. Pleasure to testify to you today. And I look forward to answering your questions and having hopefully a really good dialogue on the subject of the climate crisis that we all face, and also explaining President Biden's climate agenda. Ranking Member, I expect to have opportunity. I will address your questions, and I particularly look forward to talking with you about the Paris Agreement and China, and I think hopefully there'll be a lot of discussion here about China today. But during the campaign, President Biden identified climate crisis as one of the four historic crises facing our country, alongside COVID-19, the economic crisis, and the racial divisions in our country. And I think, personally, I think he was right to do so. Everywhere around the United States and around the world, we are all living with the mounting costs, present-day costs, of global warming and of a more volatile climate. 2020 set a new record, U.S. record, of 22 weather and climate disasters costing over $1 billion each. Last year's tally of 22 hurricanes, floods, droughts, and wildfires shattered the previous annual record of 16 such events. And that was set only 4 years ago. So these natural disasters have cost the United States, our taxpayers, more than $1.79 trillion since 1980. The 2020 U.S. wildfire season burned more than 10 million acres, an area greater than the state of Maryland. We saw five of the six biggest wildfires in California's history last year, as well as the single largest wildfire in Colorado's history. 2020 was the warmest year on record. The last decade was the warmest decade on record. The decade before that, the second warmest. The decade before that, the third warmest. You don't have to be a scientist to begin to feel that we're looking at a trend line. For the first time in our country's history, NOAA now considers Fairbanks, Alaska, as a warm summer continental climate, because for 4 months of the calendar year, the average temperature is now 50 degrees Fahrenheit or more. As my friend Secretary Blinken noted recently, we're fast running out of records to break. And that's why I was so honored to be asked by the President to lead his all-out diplomatic effort to ensure that the United States is once again a global leader in combating the climate crisis. As the Special Presidential Envoy for Climate, it's my job to make sure that the rest of the world sees that the United States is re-engaged, re-energized, and rededicated to tackling the climate crisis both at home and abroad. In practice, that means marshaling all of our resources to ensure that we can keep a 1.5 degrees Celsius within reach. That's the target. Scientists started out in Paris, ranking member, well below 2 degrees. But then, because the island states and very vulnerable nations thought that wasn't good enough, 1.5 was adopted. And now, as of 2018, when the scientists reported back on where we were, they said, we got to try and achieve the 1.5. So unless emissions targets across the world are enhanced and implemented, we are now headed into a dangerous world above 3 degrees Celsius of warming. That's the current direction we're on. Now, keeping 1.5 degrees alive is our North Star over the months to come, but achieving that goal is going to mean bending the emissions curve downward substantially by 2030. That makes this the decisive decade in the climate fight. And at home, that will entail an all-of-government effort, an interagency effort, to which my colleagues across the administration are now fully dedicated, including my good friend from Massachusetts, the National Climate Advisor, Gina McCarthy. My friends, I spent 28 years as a senator and 4 years as Secretary of State, and I have voted on important issues like you do and are now. I just share with you from an imperative sort of analysis here, these stakes could not be more serious for us, not just in terms of damage and problems, but in terms of economic possibilities, the race, if you will. Who's in the race and who isn't? And what technologies are going to define the future? The United States is contributing a declining share of global annual emissions. The Biden administration has made important and measurable strides just in the first weeks. At the President's landmark 100 days plus Climate Leaders Summit on April 22nd and 23rd, we put forward a very strong 2030 emission reduction target alongside ambitious new targets, which we worked on with Canada, with Japan, with the EU, in order to implement a stronger 2030 goal. And the UK has set a new pace-setting 2035 goal with a 78% reduction in emissions. Many of our closest allies, a coalition accounting for more than half of the global economy of the world, are now clearly committed to climate technology leadership and the pace of emissions reductions required globally to meet the goal of keeping 1.5 degrees alive. That means 55% of the global GDP is now committed to move in the direction of keeping 1.5 alive. But it also means that 45% is not yet. And that's the challenge, Ranking Member, that you raised with China and others, and we'll talk about it. South Korea came in with a recent announcement that it will strengthen its 2030 target later this year. And we're far from alone. Argentina has updated its 2030 target. It's ramping up renewables, including sourcing from U.S. suppliers. So we gain. South Africa moved forward with peaking, with setting a new peaking year, moving a full decade forward to 2025. Additionally, the Chinese government did commit to implement the Kigali Agreement to the Montreal Protocol to phase down HFCs, and they indicated that they will now strictly control coal-fired power generation projects, building on their 2020 commitment to achieve carbon neutrality before 2060. So there's much more to be done in China and elsewhere, and we're working with partner governments to secure enhanced action and additional pledges ahead of the COP26 Global Climate Summit in November. But my friends, this represents what I've described is actually the result of a pretty serious sprint that we've been engaged in since January 20th, when I came into this job and the president issued his executive orders a day later. Now, I know that today's hearing is focused on our efforts abroad, but I also know that every member here is deeply concerned with our economic health and prosperity here at home. The fact is, addressing the climate crisis is integrally related to our economic recovery here in the U.S. It's a huge opportunity for jobs, for new technology, for our communities. Yes, there's a transition involved in some of that, but we've been through transitions before as a nation. And just as America led the world in the Industrial Revolution, just as we led the technological revolution, we can and will lead the energy revolution. And just as we developed the light bulb and the airplane, and just as we developed the internet and vaccines and went to the moon, we can and will develop the battery storage technologies, the direct air capture technologies, the green hydrogen, the smart grid technologies that will change the world and stave off the catastrophic impacts of the climate crisis. There are tough choices in politics. We all know that. But this is not one of them. Because in addressing the climate crisis, we are actually taking advantage of the greatest economic opportunity the world has ever known. Before the pandemic, two of the three fastest growing jobs in the country were wind turbine technicians and solar photovoltaic installers. From 2017 to 2020, clean energy jobs grew by an average of 6% each year, faster than fossil fuels and the rest of the energy economy, and about twice the pace of the U.S. economy as a whole. We now have more Americans working in clean energy, 3 million, than we have bankers or middle and elementary school teachers, and clean energy jobs outnumber fossil fuel jobs in the U.S. 3-1. And it's broad-based. Clean energy jobs outnumber fossil fuel jobs in 81% of rural counties. So there's an even bigger growth opportunity for the U.S. in the years to come. In 2020, global investment in clean technologies crossed the $500 billion mark, and the International Energy Agency predicts that clean energy investment could triple during this decade. Solar and wind investment is forecasted to be 5 times larger than that for coal or for gas-fired power plants through 2050. That's 30 more years. It'll be 5 times higher. Similarly, the size of the global electric vehicle fleet is expected to jump to 116 million in 2030, up from only 8.5 million in 2020. Jobs and dollar figures alone don't tell the whole story. We're also seeing that clean energy can power our homes and businesses for a period. On April 24th in California, California's electrical grid was powered, California obviously being the size of, it's what, the sixth largest nation in the world. Well, on April 24th, its electrical grid was powered by 95% energy, renewable energy, without any loss in reliability or supply. Countries as diverse as Denmark, Ethiopia, and Slovakia now all power 80% or more of their grids with emissions-free generation. We've seen markets moving inexorably in the direction of clean energy and low-carbon solutions. Ahead of the summit, 6 leading United States banks pledged to mobilize $4.15 trillion of low-carbon capital by 2030. That's over the next 10 years, $4.15 trillion spent in investment. America's 3 largest U.S. asset managers also announced that $19 trillion in assets that they manage will be moved to low-carbon investments by 2050. American automakers are positioning to lead the global electric vehicle revolution. The transformation I'm talking about is not a future projection. It's happening here and now. It's a reality as we speak. The trajectory towards the new energy economy is now unmistakable in so many sectors. As we saw over the last 4 years, much of that movement is irrespective of federal action. It's not the government saying, go do this. The marketplace is moving in that direction. And so dollars are rapidly draining away from investments that don't fit squarely within that crucial 1.5 degree pathway, which in boards of directors all across our country, the boardrooms of our biggest corporations, they are talking about ESG, environment, social, and governance, and its requirements. They're talking about sustainable development goals, and they are setting their own goals in order to set investment on a different track. So members of the committee, there is already so much progress being made. There is much more work still ahead. And as we move towards the COP26 Global Summit in Scotland this November, we are clear-eyed about the bold goals that we have set for ourselves. Our engagement is designed to help build out opportunities for our country. President Biden knows how important it is for the United States to join with nations around the world to meet the challenge of the climate crisis. I served here, as I mentioned earlier, on Capitol Hill for 28 years. I've always had respect for the oversight role of Congress, and I've already had several productive exchanges with members of the committee, and I look forward to continuing those discussions in the months ahead. I welcome your guidance and your feedback and input as we work to implement a critical agenda for our nation and for the world. It's ambitious, but it's also essential. So I thank you, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Secretary Kerry, for your testimony. And I, too, look forward to a insightful conversation and dialogue and questions with our members. I want to inform all members we have a hard 1 p.m. stop. And so from henceforth, I will be adhering strictly to the 5-minute rule. So I'm going to be not meaning to be disrespectful to anyone. At 5 minutes, I will be banging the gavel.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry to impose, but I was just asking my staff. I thought we originally, I think the hearing was set from 10 to noon, and I can push to 12:30, but I am flying commercial. And have a flight that I have to make, so I have to leave here by 12:30.
Got it. Well, my information, I've been corrected, so we have an even harder 12:30. I will be very mindful of the 5-minute rule to get as many members to ask their questions as possible. I'll recognize members by committee seniority, alternating between Democrats and Republicans. If you miss your turn, please let our staff know and we will come back to you. If you seek recognition, you must unmute your microphone and address the chair verbally and identify yourself so that we know who is speaking. I will start by recognizing myself for 5 minutes. Mr. Secretary, vulnerable communities across the world are already facing severe adverse impacts of climate change through drought, crop failures, severe weather events, rising seas, and even a changing ocean chemistry. Those that can move and adapt, they will. However, historically marginalized communities will likely face the brunt of the impact in the incoming years. So my question to you is, how can we ensure that global efforts to combat climate change don't neglect these communities?
We are trying, Mr. Chairman, to pay very, very close attention. We started at the summit, and I'll tell you why. I remember in Paris, in that negotiation where I was privileged to lead our team, in the lead up to Paris, there was not enough dialogue with marginalized countries, less developed countries, people who suffer the greatest problems. There are about 138 nations on the planet, all of whom are less, they're a fraction of 1% of emissions. I mean, within fractions. But they are the ones suffering the greatest consequences. I have been on the phone in the last weeks with the president of the Marshall Islands, the president of Fiji, the prime minister of Fiji, others. They're facing not just adaptation and resilience. They may have to move altogether. Those nations, most likely, some of them are facing extinction, and it's existential for them. So we invited those nations not to wait until we get to Glasgow. We had about 20 of those nations involved in the climate summit the president just had. So the president invited the 20 biggest emitters in the world, biggest, most powerful economies. We had President Xi, we had Russia, we had Modi, so forth. But he also invited Bangladesh and the Marshall Islands and small entities, because we wanted to hear from people about this demand for adaptation and mitigation. Now, we depend on you. Congress will decide what it's willing to appropriate for this task. The president has put forward a proposal to double the amount that we're doing for adaptation and to triple the amount we're doing for resilience on behalf of other countries. And as you know, there is a Green Climate Fund. It has maybe about $10 billion in it total at that point. It is a part of the larger commitment made in Paris for the world to mobilize about $100 billion on an annual basis by 2020 in order to help those nations do what they need to do to respond to this crisis. We've never been able to get to the 100 yet. We're at 80 billion right now. And I think it's going to be very difficult in Glasgow if the developed world can't step up. Let me put this in perspective. 100 billion to try to help 138 nations that don't, some of them don't even have electricity, to be able to respond to what's happening. Measure that against the fact that about 2 or 3 years ago, we all spent here in America $265 billion just to clean up after three storms, Harvey, Maria, and Irma. Irma had the first sustained winds of 185 miles an hour for 24 hours. Harvey dropped more water in the greater Houston, Louisiana area in 5 days than goes over Niagara Falls in an entire year. And Irma and Maria, we all know, savaged the infrastructure of Puerto Rico. So if we don't want to just rebuild and rebuild, and we want to get the world enlisted in this, we've got to begin to look at some greater effort to help countries adapt and to help people build resilience so that we are a global community shifting our energy bases in an appropriate way to avoid this crisis in the long run. And I think this is something that President Biden is going to continue to try to ask you to help him with and help our country do, because a lot of people are going to suffer if we can't do that. And the military, by the way, our own military will tell you that climate crisis is a threat multiplier. And so conflict will grow as people are fighting for a place to live, a place to have water, a place to be able to feed themselves. And we already do have climate refugees on the planet. So our response.
My time has expired. I now recognize Ranking Member McCall for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and welcome, Mr. Secretary. You have a very enormous challenge, but very important one in front of you. Secretaries Blinken and Pompeo both said that the CCP is committing genocide against the Uyghur Muslim population. Last month, this committee marked up a bill I introduced along with Chairman Meeks condemning this genocide. You recently said that we're quoted saying, we have other differences on human rights, but those should not get in the way of something that is critical as dealing with climate. And I know you can try to compartmentalize it. The problem is it's intertwined. Because when you look at the supply chain, you look at China, they dominate the critical mineral supply and solar supply chains, all coming out of the Xinjiang province, which we believe is using slave labor to create these renewable energy sources. So my question to you is, how can you assure us or ensure that this quest that we're on, that slave labor coming out of China, where genocide is taking place as we speak, are never a part of the climate solution in the United States?
You're absolutely correct. Ranking Member McCall, it is a problem. Zhanjiang province not only produces some of the solar panels that we believe are being, in some cases, produced in forced labor by Uyghurs, but also there are a significant amount of rare earth mineral that's used in the solar panels themselves. It is my understanding that the Biden administration is right now in the process of assessing whether or not that will be the target of sanctions. I've heard some discussion about it. I'm not privy to where that decision is at this point in time. But I can tell you that nothing can be traded. And I've made that very clear. President Biden's made it very clear. Climate is existential for everybody on the planet. We have to deal with it. And because China is nearly 30% of all the emissions on the planet, China's got to be part of the solution, not a bigger part of the problem. So we've had very direct conversations with the Chinese on this. They have moved somewhat in the course of the last month and a half, 2 months after we've engaged. For instance, they had a peak date of peaking in terms of their emissions by 2030. That's where we began. And they were not willing to change it. And in addition, they were not even discussing mitigation during the course of the next 10 years. Well, we've been having some very serious conversations about the reality of the science, the 1.5 degrees, the need to hold it. And so China has now announced, President Xi announced, he's announced a number of things. Number one, that they believe this is a climate crisis now. Our joint statement was entitled U.S.-China Joint Statement on Climate Crisis. They've never done that. They now have in the body of the text, they've agreed they have to change and do something in the 2020-2030. They've agreed that the peaking now, they think, may be able to take place by 2025-24. We don't know yet. So we're in an ongoing negotiation with them. And where we are at the aftermath of the summit that we had, where President Xi made some of these announcements, is that we've got to go back to work. We have 5 more months left to get them to embrace something that we believe you will view, hopefully, as a legitimate, a legitimate initiative that makes sense. We're not there yet. And so I think both on the, and I've made it clear, there are serious issues, we all know, with China, issues from Hong Kong to Taiwan to the South China Sea to access to the marketplace, cyber and cyber theft and China. These are big challenges. But historically, we have always proven ourselves capable of negotiating even when we have big disagreements. Ronald Reagan went to Reykjavik and negotiated with the evil empire, Gorbachev. And they came away from there repurposing over 50,000 warheads, which we both had pointed at each other.
If I just say in closing, I think your success is going to be tied to China. And I think the more you can hold them to the same standards as the United States. The more you can hold the CCP to the same standards as the United States, I think the more successful you will be, but we're not seeing that right now.
Gentlemen's time has expired.
I just said,
I got to be strict in 5 minutes.
Sorry.
I now recognize Representative Brad Sherman of California for 5 minutes.
Ambassador Kerry, welcome back. Dealing with climate change is not free. It's not going to pay for itself. But as you point out, it is the issue of our time. It is worth the effort. There's a tendency of Americans to think it's all about us. And if we just live our lives differently, everything will be as it should. Yet the United States and the EU combined are way less than 20% of the emissions. The US is 11%, the rest of the world almost 90%. So while the whole US government, the people of the United States are focused on reducing our emissions, you and you alone are able to head the effort to deal with almost 90% of the problem, while all your fellow Americans are focused on 10 or 11% of the problem. You have an important job. And as we focused on, we're dealing with China. And China has grudgingly made a few comments. As you just pointed out, they've been willing to use the word crisis. But the fact is, even if China uses the word crisis, even if they make a commitment, they may not actually do anything on the ground. What they do on the ground is more important than what they say. And every week, they build a new large coal-fired power plant, week after week. And when you build this plant, it's not with the intention that they're going to decommission it 5 or 10 years after they put it online. As others have pointed out, they're also financing coal-fired power plants around the world. You are a very good diplomat. You're very persuasive. But all you have in your toolbox is a chance to appeal to the conscience of a regime that Ranking Member McCall has described as genocidal, a regime that puts its own people by the millions in concentration camps. And we have given you the job of appealing to their better nature, appealing to their conscience and getting them to spend hundreds of billions of dollars in order to help their fellow human beings. So my question is, would you be in a stronger position if we were threatening, gave you the power to impose an additional 10% tariff on all goods coming into the United States from China, and of course, work with our allies to do the same thing? Right now, our total average tariff on goods coming from China is less than 10%, just a bit less than 10%. And it occurs to me that you may, through great diplomacy, be able to get a genocidal and conscience-free regime to make a statement or two, but to actually get them to stop building a coal-fired power plant every year, you may need more arrows in your quiver.
Well, Congressman, thank you for the question. The fact is that Europe is considering a border adjustment mechanism, and this is a mechanism which President Biden has also asked us to evaluate as a means of placing an additional cost on the cost of goods that come from places that are not responsible in what they're doing or how they're being produced. Now, no decision has been made about deploying that or doing it, but I think Congress looking at this would be a very important analysis, an important undertaking, and so to look at the dynamics of this. But let me share with all of you, if I can. In this negotiating process, I learned over the years, both negotiating in the Senate and here in Congress, but more importantly with other countries, and especially in the Iran nuclear agreement, Ronald Reagan had a saying, trust but verify. We changed that a little bit and had a saying, don't trust, but verify. And in this endeavor with China, you got to be eyes wide open. You can't go in and just take words.
I apologize to you, Mr. Secretary, but members, are we mindful again, if you want your questions answered, you've got to reduce the amount of time you have to ask them, because I'm stopping at 5 minutes. I now recognize Representative Chris Smith of New Jersey, who's the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Africa, Global Health, and Global Human Rights, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and Mr. Secretary. Welcome to the committee. As you know, under President Xi Jinping, human rights abuse throughout China has significantly worsened, including the pervasive use of torture, religious persecution, human trafficking, and genocide against Muslim Uyghurs. Paper promises made by Beijing, as you know as well, are simply not kept. Broken promises are the rule, not the exception under Xi. And the people of Hong Kong are suffering as we speak because of it. As you know, Xi Jinping has completely reneged on the promises made in the 84 Sino-British Joint Declaration that facilitated the conveyance of Hong Kong from the UK to China, meeting on July 1st, 1997, that autonomy, human rights, including press, assembly, association, religion, would be exactly the same as before the handover for at least 50 years. Xi Jinping has completely reneged on promises made in the basic law of Hong Kong, adopted by the Chinese China People's Congress in 1990, before the give back, that autonomy, human rights, and adherence to the rule of law would be protected. The Chinese Communist Party, again, as you know, has not been truthful concerning the origin of COVID-19. The CCP tells lies concerning the genocide against the Uyghurs and continues to blatantly violate its WTO obligations, UN sanctions on North Korea, and so much more. So two questions. Did you raise during your trip with leaders of the Chinese Communist Party, did you raise human rights in general? Did you ask them to stop the genocide against the Uyghurs and the brutal suppression of Hong Kong and other massive acts of cruelty? And if you did, how did they respond? And secondly, given the Chinese Communist Party's massive unwillingness to honor its word, do you believe the CCP will honor its word on climate? Mr. Secretary?
I have always raised the issue of human rights in every conversation I ever had as secretary, anywhere I was, we raised that issue. But
on this trip as well, Mr. Secretary?
Yeah, but I'm just about to get to it. And this trip, I raised it with the Chinese officials, not the climate folks, because the climate emissary for China, Xie Zhenhua, has been their special envoy in climate for about 20 years. And, you know, we could casually talk about it, but he doesn't have any input or capacity to do anything on it. But I've raised it at the highest level with officials in China. And they deny certain things that we allege, obviously, and move on. It's a wall of, so, you know, different attitude about what they're willing to acknowledge and not acknowledge. Clearly, we have a very different perception of what's happening, for instance, in Xinjiang than they are willing to acknowledge. So a decision has to be made, whether by Congress or the administration, how we will respond to that. Now, you have legislation, Ranking Member McCall, and maybe that's the way it's going to be responded to. That's not my lane. My lane is very specifically to try to get the Chinese to move to do what we need to do with respect to climate itself. And I'll just point out something to everybody on the committee. China is already the leading producer in the world of solar panels, wind turbines, electric vehicles, and lithium-ion batteries. They produced 72% of all the solar panels globally in 2019. That's up from the last year when they were at 67%. U.S. companies only produced a very minor amount compared to that. So,
Ms. Stecker, I know the chairman will have to cut me off and everybody else with 5 minutes, but do you believe that they will honor their word on this issue of climate?
As I said earlier, it's don't trust and verify. You have to set up a structure where you're doing things which you can see happening and you can measure. And that's what's critical here. This is not a question of relying on somebody's word. But I do want to share with you, and I wanted to share this a moment ago in answer to the prior question. Let me just share with you what was published in an internal meeting of President Xi with the Communist Party members about a week and a half ago, and this is new. Quote, President Xi, China will make cutting emissions a focus of its ecological strategy in the next 5 years. President Xi Jinping said, he vowed is used, to cut off projects which consume a lot of energy and can't meet environmental standards. And he talked about moving away from coal, how they're going to do it. Now, we're going to have to check on that.
The gentleman's time has expired.
I'd rather have those words than not have them. And now we get into the verification.
The gentleman's time has expired.
I now recognize Representative Albio Ceres of New Jersey, who's the chair of the Subcommittee on the Western Hemisphere, Civilian Security, Migration, and International Economic Policy for 5 minutes.
Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. During President Biden's leaders' summit on climate, Brazil pledged to achieve net zero emissions by 2050 and eliminate illegal deforestation by 2030. One day after making this pledge, President Bolsonaro approved a 24% cut to the environmental budget for 2021. What should the U.S. policy towards the Brazilian Amazon consist of, and how can we address the consistent lack of adequate spending on environmental regulations by the current government in Brazil?
That's a terrific question, and the answer is we're trying to set up a new structure of verification and accountability. Promises have been made in the past. Brazil actually did quite well between 2004 and 2012. Deforestation was making they were making progress in stopping it, but in 2012 to 2020, Amazon reached a 12-year high in the level of deforestation. And unfortunately, the Bolsonaro regime had rolled back some of the environmental enforcement. We've had this conversation. They say they are committed now to raise the budget, and they are going to put together a new structure. We are willing to talk to them, not with any blinders on, but with an understanding of where we've been. But if we don't talk to them, you're guaranteed that that forest is going to disappear. And scientists are telling us today that the level of cutting of the forest is so significant that there's the possibility you reached a tipping point already in the ability of the forest to remain a rainforest. In fact, a week ago, there was an article saying that the Amazon is now releasing more carbon than it is consuming. So we've already, something's going on. So we need to figure that out. The bottom line is we're going to engage in order to try to find out what is possible. And we'll report back to you. I assure you, before we wind up going to Glasgow, we'll have a better sense of where we are in the next months.
Thank you. And going to the Northern Triangle, the dry corridor of Central America has been experiencing years of severe drought and floods, made much worse by the climate crisis. These impacts are destroying livelihood across Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador, and pushing people to migrate to the U.S. out of desperation. Are we planning to deal with this in this Northern Triangle, these countries, to stop this push north because of the severe drought in the area?
I hope we are. I think people are trying to put together those responses now, from what I understand. When I was secretary and the president was the vice president, we became very involved with those countries, with Guatemala, with Honduras, with El Salvador. We went down there. We met with the presidents. And we tried to, because we also saw the connection of what was happening with their dislocation and then the pressure on the border of the United States. It was part of the pressure of people moving because they couldn't grow things anymore. And then that kind of serious impact on their livelihoods. So what we're doing now is trying to figure out what, back then, we put some money on the table. We helped them deal with some of the problems within their community to be able to hold on to those populations and to be able to provide a food chain and a capacity to survive. But this is a harbinger of what may come as more and more regions are not able to pursue the livelihood that they used to pursue in the way that they did, because the climate is changing. So I know the administration is focused on this now and trying to mobilize initiative.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Gentleman yields back. I now recognize Representative Steve Chabot of Ohio, who's the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Asia, the Pacific, Central Asia, and Nonproliferation for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, as has already been stated, the PRC is one of the worst actors on the world scene, whether We're talking about stealing $500 billion of our intellectual property every year, or employing unfair trade practices that undermine our economy and destroy American jobs, or conducting massive military buildup, or using aggressive bullying tactics against Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, India, Australia, Vietnam, and others. In fact, if you read an article in the Wall Street Journal this morning, you can even add Sweden to that list, not to mention the atrocities against the Uyghurs, Tibetans, Falun Gong, the crackdown on Hong Kong, and a variety of other behaviors aimed at reorienting the world to revolve around Beijing. Indeed, when he testified in March, Secretary Blinken said that confronting this menace is the biggest geopolitical test of the 21st century. Now, I know you're focused on climate, but the American people deserve to know where this administration's priorities really are. Is it climate change that's the top priority for this administration, or is it confronting a more and more aggressive Chinese Communist Party? I know you'll probably say something along the lines that we can walk and chew gum at the same time, and I get that. But when push comes to shove, and the president has to either play nice with China to get them to cooperate on climate change, or confront them on their latest attempt at stealing American jobs, or bullying an ally, or committing genocide, what's it going to be, Mr. Secretary, in your opinion?
It has to be all of the above. There's no choice. This is not an either-or, and the president doesn't see it as either-or. The best way the United States of America, frankly, can aggregate our efforts to deal with these many different legitimate concerns about China's behavior is for us to be strong. The stronger the United States is, you're going to address more of these issues. And by stronger, I mean one of the things that I overheard years ago was the new narrative that's coming out of China about how this century is the century of China, and the United States is in decline, and the West is in decline, and the liberal order of the West is in decline, and that they can't make decisions, and they can't pass budgets, and they don't get anything done. They're not investing in their country. I have heard this out there. And I just have to tell you that the best thing we could do is be more competitive. When I say 73% of these items are being built in China and sold around the world, they're cornering the market on that, why aren't we? What has happened to us that we're not the country that's pushing the curve on the technology, on the R&D? Now, that's what President Biden has put forward.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. The chair has been... he's been pretty strict with our time, and I'm running out of time, so I want to get one more question in if I
sure.
can. And I commend
Sorry
him for being strict with all of us.
No, fine.
When you signed the Paris Agreement and praised China for participating, China at that time emitted about 20% of the total global emissions. Now they've gone up to 27%. And even though the previous administration had pulled us out, we've been going down. And in fact, since 2005, we've gone down, I believe it's 4 billion tons, a billion tons, and they've gone up 4 billion tons. So they're going in just the wrong direction, and we're going in the right direction, and I think the United States should be commended for that. But as some of the other members have indicated, even if we reach an agreement with the PRC on this, in light of the fact that they pretty much break every international agreement that they make, why should we trust them? I know we say trust and verify, but there's a lot of skepticism on not only by this committee, I think, but the American people for good reason overall. So in the short time that I've got left, could you address that lack of trust to the PRC as to whether they'll follow up and agree to this?
Well, obviously, the lack of trust is real. I mean, they don't trust us, and we don't trust them. And we have to find a way forward in the midst of that because we have a global crisis that can't be solved by any one.
Gentleman's time has expired. I now recognize Representative Jerry Connolly of Virginia, who's the president of the NATO Parliamentary Assembly, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you for holding this hearing, and welcome back, Mr. Secretary, to the House Foreign Affairs Committee. And thank you for addressing the Sustainable Energy and Environmental Caucus last week. Really appreciated your presentation. Wonder if you could talk a little bit about the engagement with our alliance, the North Atlantic Alliance's membership especially. Secretary General of NATO, Jens Stoltenberg, comes from Norway, has visited Svalbard, has seen firsthand the effects in the Arctic of climate change, the retreat of glaciers, the opening up of the Arctic waterways to additional shipping and exploitation of natural resources. How, especially with the alliance, can we anchor a commitment to reversing climate change, addressing climate change, with the alliance specifically? And how did those conversations go when you met with the European Council and other allied members in Europe?
Well, thank you, Jerry. Jens Stoltenberg, the head of NATO, is deeply committed on the climate issue, and he is also very seized by the reality that this is a defense security issue. And he together with Secretary Austin, General Austin, also, and General Milley, are both seized by the notion that they have serious challenges within the military to deal with respect to readiness, deployment, conflict. There are a lot of demands that are falling on the military. There's not a, quote, military solution here, but the military has a big carbon footprint, and it's already wrestling with the issue of fuels for aircraft, supply chains, and so forth. I think, there are also some interesting contributions that current military capacity may provide with respect to the provision of power, because there are small unit nuclear capacity energy providers in literally small mobile reactors. And that may be something that is going to be combined with the technology that Bill Gates is pursuing for small modular reactors, which he is building a prototype on. And I met with a group at MIT recently who were talking about the possibilities of literally what they call a quantum battery, which is a small nuclear battery that is the size of sort of a container, the length of these tables. So they're very exciting things that Jens Stoltenberg and the military is starting to grapple with about how they will contribute their part, as well as be ready for the crises and the challenges that may come as a consequence of the threat multiplier that they believe the challenge is.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary, and thank you for your leadership. I'm so glad you're in the position you are. We look forward to supporting you over the coming years. I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. I now recognize Representative Joe Wilson of South Carolina, who's the ranking member of the Subcommittee on the Middle East, North Africa, and Global Counterterrorism, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Greg Meeks, for your leadership, very positive leadership. Secretary Kerry, taking up with the issues of Congressman Steve Chabot, last week a report revealed the People's Republic of China greenhouse gas emissions exceeded those of the United States and other developed countries combined. China currently accounts for nearly 30% of global greenhouse gas emissions, not including emissions associated with the Belt and Road Initiative. Do these trends show a serious commitment to its advertised targets?
Great question. Let me be clear, and I want everybody to, I agree with your fundamental premise. China produces more emissions than all the rest of the OECD countries put together. They are currently funding external coal-fired power. And what we've been working on, this is one of the things we've really engaged on, and quite We've had some very heated discussions about this because obviously it's not sustainable. There's no way the United States and the rest of the world can get to our goal if China doesn't join in and become part of it. It's not just China. There are other countries that are part of that 45%. We need to see greater reductions in India. India, however, Prime Minister Modi has made a commitment to deploy 450 gigawatts of renewable energy. We have created a partnership with India because of that commitment, because they don't have the finance and technology completely. So we're going to try to help them bring the technology to the table, bring the finance to the table, and they have to do certain things internally to make this happen. But if you deploy in the next 10 years 450 gigawatts of renewables, then India is in keeping with the 1.5 degrees. So it's a huge step forward. It's worth the investment.
And Mr. Secretary, I'm so grateful for the leadership
of Prime Minister
Narendra Modi. What a great job he has done for the people of India. On another issue, what's the administration's justification for canceling the Keystone XL pipeline, which created American jobs, but refusing to implement the required sanctions on Nord Stream 2 pipeline, which promotes the Russian intimidation of Europe?
Well, I don't know where the latest is on the Nord Stream, so I can't speak to that here with any authority. What I can tell you is that on the Keystone, the administration is trying to put teeth in its words and its commitment to the climate crisis. We do not need to be building that additional infrastructure at this moment when we have other options for which are readily available to us for how we supply and what we supply. We need to do a greater build out of alternative renewable in this country.
But Mr. Secretary, this destroys jobs in the district I represent. The tires that are used for the at Fort McMurray, Alberta, Canada, are made in South Carolina. And so you're destroying jobs all over the United States of what had been an achievement, and that is energy independence. And that needs to be promoted. And so I deeply regret. And then Nord Stream 2, what that does to Europe is just so sad for the people of our allies across Europe. Thank you very much.
Well,
and I yield back.
Congressman,
would the gentleman yield?
Could I just use a little bit of time?
The time belongs to Mr. Wilson. There's a request.
I yield.
I thank you, Mr. Chairman. I apologize. I didn't mean to cut you off. If we can both talk. Go ahead, Mr. Secretary.
No, I was just going to say that we opposed Nord Stream, as I think you know. We the Obama administration, myself, we were involved in those discussions, and notwithstanding, they went forward, and you know what the state of play is right now. But I just very quickly say to you, we should not be leaving people behind, and that's President Biden's code here. He does not believe that doing this transition has to be massive job loss.
Well, and Mr. Secretary, quickly on behalf of the member I yielded, the cancellation of this pipeline in the United States does not change the amount of oil. It does change how that oil is coming through. Isn't it true that pipelines are more carbon delivery efficient than trains or trucks or other forms of delivery? If you could answer just that limited question.
Yeah, that is true. I think that is true. But it doesn't mean you necessarily want to be adding another line when there are other alternatives. But is it better than train and better than not? Yes, it is.
Thank you.
My judgment.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Gentleman's time has expired. I now recognize Representative Ted Deutsch of Florida, who's the chair of the Subcommittee on the Middle East, North Africa, and Global Counterterrorism for 5 minutes.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, Secretary Kerry. It's good to have you back. Your appointment as special presidential envoy is, I think, a strong signal by President Biden right out of the gate that he attaches great significance to this issue. I've been heartened by your administration's pace, ambition, and I think pragmatism, as evidenced by the bold yet achievable initiatives that were announced at the President's Summit last month. As the founder and co-chair of the bipartisan House Climate Solutions Caucus and a member of Congress from South Florida, I know firsthand how important it is that we approach the challenge with realism as much as with urgency. Sea level rise, intensity of storms, so many ways that climate change is impacting us right now. That's why we reintroduced the Energy Innovation and Carbon Dividend Act in April to put a price on carbon. The legislation will help the U.S. reach net zero carbon emissions by 2050 and will return 100% of the net revenue back to American families to help them afford any increase in energy costs and have money left over to help with the daily expenses as our nation recovers still from the pandemic economy. So I wanted just to ask about your coordination with our geopolitical partners on how to present a united front when dealing with countries with which we have a more adversarial or difficult relationship. So you talked earlier about the EU. If you could expand upon that, is part of the strategy to stay aligned with the EU specifically on carbon pricing schemes and carbon tariffs so that we can collectively pressure China on this issue more effectively? Let's start with that.
No decision has been made at this point in time about carbon pricing. The president is not in his current plan. He is obviously embracing a clean electricity standard. That would be one big step forward if Congress were to come together on that. But I think you all need to develop further what that proposal might look like and whether or not it's passable.
We do have to do that. We will have those conversations. This is a moment when so many, as you well know, so many companies already price carbon in their own analysis. They're simply waiting, as I think so many are, for the price to be imposed so that we can actually see and this urgent approach that will get us to net zero. But I just want to get back to the question. You could broaden it if you like, if you care not to talk about carbon pricing, but just generally staying aligned with the EU and bringing collective pressure on China. Can you speak to that, the approach that you're taking there and how that can lead to the results that we're all looking for?
Well, I just had a meeting yesterday, or I think it was yesterday or the day before, with all of the European foreign ministers. I did it virtually, obviously, with them in Brussels. And we discussed exactly this, is alignment as we go into these next 5 months going into Glasgow. We agreed to work extremely closely together, that we needed to unify, particularly with respect to some of our conversations with China, with other countries where we're trying to move more rapidly to a mutuality of effort here. So the answer is yes, we're trying to align as much as we can, but we're also trying to solicit from them help with other countries. My small staff that I have is engaged with really major dialogues with about 25 nations right now. Running around the world, Indonesia and Australia and many others. And we're trying to get Europe to come together with us in that effort because there's much that they can bring to the table. They have great expertise, great technology, and a huge commitment on this because Europe has committed to a 55% reduction. And in Germany, the Constitutional Court of Germany just decided that the government was not doing enough for future generations. And Angela Merkel, the chancellor, had to go back to the government. They just put together a new plan. They've moved up by 5 years their commitment to net zero, and they've raised the level of their reductions to about 65%. So there's a serious effort here, which we hope to bring to the table.
Gentlemen's time has expired. I now recognize the representative.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman. Point of order.
Point of order.
Are our questions and the Secretary's responses so unimportant that we must cut him off? I know we want to get to everybody, but we are here to hear his answers. Is that so important?
And as I reminded members, you can form your questions without statements. If you make statements, it's going to mean his reduction of time.
Totally agree, but can we hear his answers?
If within the time frame of 5 minutes, you can.
So not that important, check.
I now recognize Representative Scott Perry of Pennsylvania for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, Would you say you have a good relationship with Foreign Minister Zarif?
Right now, I don't have a relationship with the Foreign Minister.
Well, when you had one, when you were negotiating, was it good or was it bad?
I would characterize it as professional.
Okay, professional. You still got a security clearance?
Do I?
Yes.
Yes, I do.
You do. Okay, so you're a smart guy, Navy lieutenant, senator for many decades, Secretary of State. You know that since 1979, Iran is responsible for killing more Americans than any other nation state, right? I suppose you know that.
I've heard that.
Yeah, of course. You went to Yale, so you're probably familiar with 50 U.S. Code 2204, 18 U.S. Code 2381. I suspect I'm not going to get into it. If you want me to, I will. But, Mr. Secretary, the foreign minister claimed that you had discussed more than 200 Israeli operations against Iranian-backed terrorists in Syria. Did you provide information to Mr. Zarif on Israeli operations against Iranian-backed terrorists during or following your tenure as Secretary of State?
On no occasion. Never.
Never. So Mr. Zarif is a liar.
Mr. Zarif may be confused or incorrect, or he's trying to embellish his... What I read about that article said that he was portraying himself as out of the loop and whatever, and quite emotional, apparently, is what I read. And I've seen him be quite emotional, and I can't vouch for why he did or what he said. I'm just telling you, that didn't happen. End of story.
That never happened. And I know you're not under oath, but we've seen many administration officials come to this Congress and lie straight-faced to members of Congress. You're saying, for the record, never occurred.
The first time I ever heard this number 200 was when I read the article a few days ago. I've never heard of that.
Well, that is heartening to hear, but I will tell you that there's reason for suspicion in this Congress and across America, and I just want to go through the record. In 1985, U.S. Senator traveled to Nicaragua against the administration's wishes to meet with Marxist leader Daniel Ortega. In 2006, you traveled to Syria to meet with the dictator Bashar al-Assad, contradicting President Bush's efforts to isolate Assad for supporting Hezbollah. And I remind you that it's a sea of war and horrifying activities in Syria right now. I mean, if we could have done something with Assad then, maybe we wouldn't be dealing with what we're dealing with now. In 2018, you told the Palestinian Authority to hold on. The Palestinian Authority to hold on and be strong and play for time and do not yield to the president's demands. And finally, following your term as secretary, we know that you met with Mr. Zarif. I know that you said you had a professional relationship. Apparently it wasn't a good relationship, but it was professional enough that you met with him at least three times to discuss how to save the JCPOA, undermining President Trump's peace efforts. I remind you that as we speak, the Iranian proxy Hamas is raining down rockets across Israel right now. That's why people are right to be skeptical. That's why we asked this question. And so you say you're surprised and have no recollection of ever discussing these activities with Zarif regarding Israel and Syria. One more time, Mr. Secretary.
I didn't even know about this number, as I said, until we read the article the other day.
But, I'm not asking about the number.
No, I never had a discussion with him about Israel with respect to attacks or anything. No, I told you. That's the end of the story. But I wanted to say something about what you just said. I traveled to Nicaragua as a United States senator with another United States senator, an officially sanctioned United States Senate trip, in order to try to learn about what was happening with respect to the war in El Salvador. And you know, Ortega was one of many people we met with. We met with people like you do on any given trip as a member of the United States Congress. And we were handed a letter we brought back to the United States. We turned it over to President Reagan and to Vice President Bush. They had a big meeting about it because he was offering some kind of peace initiative. And that was the end of it. We didn't have any further involvement or engagement.
He's a brutal dictator and a communist.
You're damn just, right.
Yeah, that's exactly right. You should be supporting America.
The gentleman's time has expired. I now recognize Representative Karen Bass of California, who's the chair of the Subcommittee on Africa, Global Health, and Global Human Rights for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Secretary, for taking the time out with us today.
Thank you.
Before I ask my question, and I did want to talk about Africa, similar to the conversation we were having before the hearing, was there anything else you were trying to say that you didn't have time to?
Simply that I think it's important for people to understand that in the course of being an ex-secretary, you do wind up going to various events that you're invited to, and you have conversations with people. For instance, Munich Security Conference. There are only 4 times that I know of that I saw Prime Minister Zarif in the aftermath of being secretary, and they were all at an international event or a sanctioned period of time. I don't think that... I don't think it needs any further comment.
Okay, no problem. I wanted to ask, how do we balance our interests abroad with our domestic interests and all that we need to do in terms of maintaining the pace of the growth of jobs in the renewable energy space, and then what it is that we're trying to do internationally, especially in regard to Africa?
But what was the first part of the question?
About how we maintain our interest abroad. I mean, we have our goals around climate domestically, and obviously
sure.
The connection internationally, but the international focus I wanted to zero in on is.
Well, I think, thank you, Representative. It's a very important focus. The fact is that Africa is one of the most negatively affected continents as a consequence of the climate crisis. And it is exacerbated by virtue of the fact that so much of Africa is still undeveloped, less developed. I mean, there are about 860 million people with no electricity, and most of them are in Africa. And so we have an enormous challenge in order to help with adaptation, help with resilience, but also in the doing of that, to help with development. We used to do that more. Right now, people are legitimately complaining about some of the things that are happening out there with respect to either China or another country. But the fact is that China is filling a void. We used to do that. We don't do it now.
Could you imagine a possibility of the EU and the United States working together to address an infrastructure problem like you mentioned, 2/3 of the continent
sure.
of Africa doesn't have electricity. Could you envision the EU? The EU's going through its whole reckoning. They have the issue with the migrants. We know why they travel and risk their lives.
I could easily envision that. I think it would be very productive. But it does require some funding. It's very hard to do if you're not in that business anymore. And to a large measure, we have stepped back. Our budget over the years, I think, the total budget of everything we do abroad with USAID and our embassies and the entire State Department is around $51 billion or so, 52, somewhere in there. I don't have the latest figure. But it hasn't changed in a number of years, been cut to some degree in the last few years. So we can't do that.
Do you see this administration proposing significant
Well, I don't
increases?
Know what the president's going to decide. He's got the 4 crises he's trying to deal with now. He's got to build back from COVID. Mm-hmm. You all have rapidly addressed the initial legislation. There's obviously more coming. But hopefully we will get back in that business. It begins here at home. I understand that. It begins here at home. But you've got to be able to go further abroad also. I mean, we're now actually down to 11% of the world's emissions. Last year, we were at 15%. I mean, we've moved down. But that means that 89% is in the rest of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no way to solve this crisis Mother Nature doesn't decide, oh, it's only coming from here, it's coming from there. It's the conglomerate amount that makes the difference. And if 89% of it is coming from the rest of the world, we, as a leading economy, leading nation, need to step up in order to help those other people be able to solve a problem, because it's our problem too.
In the international conferences, is there ever any attention paid or focus to Africa?
Gentlelady's time has expired.
The answer is yes.
I now recognize Representative Adam Kinzinger of Illinois for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Mr. Secretary. Thank you for spending a little time with us to echo your comments about development and competition. I think it's important. If we, you know, we can't both cut our international affairs and funding and development budget and then expect to be able to compete with China when they're using money as a soft power weapon. And I think that's an important point. More to the task at hand, I'm a strong supporter of the all of the above approach to fighting climate change. And I fear that some, including the administration and our allies, have written off the largest source of carbon-free energy on the planet. For example, the EU has developed policies that exclude nuclear energy from their green goals. As you may know, my district's home to 4 nuclear power plants that are critical for the US goal of cutting carbon emissions. Unfortunately, years of regulatory hurdles have left many of these plants on weak financial footing. Would it be possible for the United States to meet our climate change goals if we took a similar approach to nuclear as our European colleagues have? And maybe with that, if you can explain why in the fight against climate change, the EU appears to be taking this tool off the table.
The nuclear tool off the table?
Yes, sir.
Well, Germany has very much taken it off the table. Others have not. As you know, France provides about 70-some percent of all their power comes from nuclear. 20% of our power comes from nuclear. We have another nuclear plant, I think, coming on. China is building, I think, 12 or 13 nuclear plants. And so they're trying to diversify a little bit. But nuclear has been off the table, obviously, for a number of reasons. It became uneconomical in the aftermath of a combination of Three Mile Island, Fukushima, and Chernobyl. And the economics of it don't work at the current moment. On the other hand, there are lots of people who believe that it may become very difficult to get the kind of baseload guarantee we need for our businesses and our homes and communities without having something like small next generation, fourth generation modular nuclear as part of the mix. So it is being pursued. I think the US government is currently putting something like $500 million or so into the R&D and development of this. Bill Gates is putting a similar amount of his own money into it and building a prototype. It may well be that this is going to come back into the dialogue because the pace at which we have to reduce is so significant. I am told by scientists and experts in the field of emissions reduction that about 50% of all the emissions we need to cut are going to come from technologies that we have not yet developed or taken to the marketplace. So that's astounding. So whether it's direct air carbon capture or green hydrogen or storage, we still have a lot of discovering to do. And whoever breaks through on those things, boy, that's going to be, that'll be competition for the wealth of Amazon and Bezos and others. It's going to be an extraordinary amount of money made by people who come up with several weeks of storage or with a cheap green hydrogen.
Thank you, sir. I don't mean to cut you off. I just do have another question and appreciate it. So I introduced with Congresswoman Spanberger the Energy Resources Governance Initiative Act, which would formalize an initiative at state to make sure that the U.S. and our allies are leading the way in responsible mineral sourcing. Unfortunately, many of our clean energy technologies purchase their materials from the Chinese Communist Party, who are the world's leading polluters. What else can be done not only to push back on the CCP's policies, but to encourage American companies to source their materials from responsible partners?
Well, I think you create incentives. That's something that you all have a huge capacity to do. And you know, I think the second thing to do is get aggressively into those markets. I mean, clearly the tax credit on renewables has worked. It's been extremely effective. And so we're seeing, I think, you know, the more you create one incentive or another in the directions that we need to move, the more impact you're going to have on the marketplace.
Well, thank you, sir. And let me just close with saying that just another plug that I hope the administration pushes forward on the congressionally mandated sanctions on Nord Stream 2. Had a question, but no time, so I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman's time has expired. I now recognize Representative Bill Keaton of Massachusetts, who's the chair of the Subcommittee on Europe, Energy, and the Environment and Cyber for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here. You know, just in the last couple of days, we had a landmark decision affecting U.S. energy policy here in the United States with the record of decision on Vineyard Wind, which is the first major offshore wind project in our nation. You know, it was just 7 months ago that the former president was using wind power as a punchline in his campaign rallies, and within the next 7 months, we're likely to be breaking ground under the Biden administration in construction on this project. This project really meets so many of our needs and priorities, our energy goals, our environmental goals, and our employment goals, good jobs. And this project also unlocks the projects for the whole Eastern Seaboard. Now, this project alone, one project, would have enough energy produced for 400,000 homes for all their energy needs for a year. And the potential on the Eastern Seaboard is for 10 million homes being able to get their power from offshore wind in the future as well for a whole year. It's a great example of a public-private partnership. And with your efforts with the administration and internationally, to me, I get great optimism out of seeing the private investment that's going to occur. That's going to help us meet our goals. Without it, we won't be successful. The Biden administration and their tax policies recognize this in terms of clean energy tax credits and advancing clean electricity production by providing a 10-year extension and production tax credits, investment tax credits for energy generation, whether it's solar, wind, or energy storage. That's just part of what they're doing. But you touched upon it in your opening remarks. We have to get a partnership on the private side going forward. Can you give us a little more detail about the Glasgow Financial Alliance for Net Zero, and which aims to bring together 160 firms with assets in excess of $70 trillion? And also, could you touch upon how we can use our alliances, our transatlantic alliances with our partners, to better coordinate the private investment side of how we're going to finance this going forward? It's a very important issue. And if you could take the remainder of your time, my time, just touching on the potential that's there, what your plan is, what can be done.
Well, thank you, Congressman. Thank you very much. And I agree with you that it's very exciting what is happening with Martha's Vineyard wind possibilities. I really am excited about having a chance to share this with our colleagues here. And I particularly want to call attention of this to our friends on the other side of the aisle. I think that when you look at this challenge of climate crisis, the UN has done a thorough analysis of what it's going to cost us. Most economists will tell you today that it is more expensive not to respond to the climate crisis than it is to respond. And the private sector understands this. In Europe, they're demanded disclosure with respect to investments, and they have a new standard on disclosure with respect to investing. What's happened is the largest asset managers in the world, the BlackRocks and the Vanguards and others, have made a decision already that this is an area for major investment and investment return. It's not a giveaway. And so banks have come together. The six major banks in the United States, our biggest banking institutions, have volunteered that they are going to commit in climate sector over the next 10 years $4.16 trillion. And they have joined a thing called the Net Zero Asset Managers Initiative. There is, in addition to that, a Net Zero Banking Alliance. There is a Net Zero Asset Owner Alliance. That's 37 institutions with $5 trillion. The Net Zero Banking Alliance is 28 trillion in assets. 43 banks have committed to this. And the Glasgow Financial Alliance for Net Zero brings a lot of those others all together. So there are about 130 financial institutions worth 100 and some trillion dollars in assets being managed or lending. They are committed to be investing in this sector over the course of the next years. That is going to be...
Gentleman's time has expired. I'm sorry, Mr. Secretary. I now recognize Representative Lee Zeldin of New York for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Kerry, did you meet with Iranian Foreign Minister Zarif in Munich during the Munich Security Conference in February 2019?
I don't know if I met with him in 2019. I don't have a recollection of 2019.
I
know I met with him in 2018, and I met with him. I met with him, I think, twice in 2018 and twice in 2017.
Do you recall meeting him in Munich during the Munich Security Conference?
I recall meeting him. I just can't remember exactly which year or when it was.
Were there other U.S. participants in that meeting?
Well, I think it was not a meeting. I think I just...
Were there other U.S.
pleasantries?
Were there other Americans with you in that discussion?
I don't recall. There were in one or two, but I don't recall which one.
In the meetings that you did have U.S. participants, who were the U.S. participants?
In Oslo, I met with, I think a fellow named John Finer might have been with me in Oslo. I don't know. In New York, I can't remember who was with me in New York. It was during the UNGAR, during the United Nations meeting. And the Oslo meeting was a public event, which I did with the High Representative of EU, the former High Representative of EU. No, she was then still sitting High Representative. And it was hosted by the Norwegian Peace Institute.
I'm just asking which U.S. participants were in the meeting. Any other names?
But I remember I had other people with me. I have to go back and figure out. I don't recall who was the traveling party.
Did the discussion involve foreign affairs?
Writ large, yeah.
Did it involve U.S. foreign policy?
It involved sort of listening to views of what is happening in the world, where are we, where are we going, what do you think about this? It was a general conversation, similar to one, by the way, that many members of Congress met with him during that same period when I was in New York and had a meeting in New York. He met with Congress, he met with the New York Times editorial board, he was on TV.
Yeah,
it was
I'm just asking about your meetings. Any other meetings with, how many meetings did you have with Zarif during the Trump administration?
I think during the Trump administration I had 4 meetings.
Did you have any phone calls with Zarif during the Trump administration?
No.
Would messages, communications be passed between the two of you separately?
No, the only time we ever had any communication was about the specific meeting to get together to compare notes on what was happening in the world.
Did you obtain any classified information during the Trump administration?
No.
Do you recall having a conversation with the House Intelligence Committee Chairman Adam Schiff at the Munich Security Conference? Do you recall having an extended conversation with the House Intelligence Committee Chairman Adam Schiff at the Munich Security Conference?
I think we had a beer in the Ratskeller underneath the thing, but I don't recall specifically very much.
Okay, there was a main room, because I was there as well. There was a main room where there was a bunch of speakers, and I was there, I watched. I mean, you guys had an extended conversation. You don't recall that conversation?
In the main hall?
Yes.
It's entirely possible. I remember sitting with him having a beer. It's more fun.
But you don't recall having that conversation with the chairman?
I don't recall the conversation. I think he sat beside me. We sat on the right side of the hall looking towards the stage, and I think we sat there.
You guys were standing, but when you guys met with Zarif, when you were talking about U.S. foreign policy, would you advocate for your position on policy?
The only time I didn't advocate for my position, when I met with him, during the period of time I met with Zarif, we were in the agreement. From the time the President Trump pulled out of the agreement in May of 2018, and I don't recall having another conversation with Zarif after that.
Well, we're running out of time. We have one president at a time, and those conversations weren't helpful. I yield back.
Well, one president at a
time. Gentleman's time has expired. I now recognize Representative David Cicilline of Rhode Island for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you for your service to our country. I just want to correct my friend, Mr. Keating. Of course, Rhode Island is the offshore wind capital of America. The project he's speaking about is the second one, and we welcome the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to the industry. But it's exciting for Rhode Island and Massachusetts, but obviously particularly exciting for us in Rhode Island as we lead the industry in this area. There's been a lot of discussion about the importance of climate, responding to the climate crisis because of the consequences to our planet, our ability to maintain a habitable planet, and obviously understanding the economic opportunities that renewable energies present. But I'd also like you to spend a moment talking about what the implications are to conflicts around the world. We know climate change risks starting, prolonging, or exacerbating armed conflicts around the world. The UN Security Council meeting organized by the United Kingdom recently sought to expose the links between our warming climate and conflict. We've seen how drought has made the conflict in Syria that much more difficult, and how states like Mali face threats from insurgents because of issues like food insecurity. And I think it's one thing that people don't hear enough about, and so I'd love to hear your thoughts on the nexus between climate change and conflict, and why, if we don't invest in a real climate response, that we might risk further conflicts in the future. And then the second question, and I'll give you time to answer both of them, is there was a recent report by the UN Environment Program that outlines the importance of dramatically and quickly reducing global emissions of methane, and because of all the dangers that methane presents, and particularly since methane helps create smog, cutting emissions in half could prevent as many as 250,000 deaths each year worldwide if we do this. Can you speak about the UNEP report and what steps the Biden administration is taking, both here in the United States and in concert with our partners around the world, to reduce methane emissions?
I'll try to run through that really quickly. First of all, the implications of the climate crisis to all of us in terms of foreign policy and military are that you could have millions of people who are homeless. Literally, their habitat is no longer habitable. Last year in Pakistan, it was 130 degrees in one community. In the Middle East, it was 130 degrees. Here in California, in Death Valley, it was 130 degrees. The human body is not prepared, or it's not meant to be living in 130 degrees. It's going to go up still in some of those places. We've seen heat waves in the ocean, literally, with massive die-off and impact on the food protein source for millions, billions of people, actually. So as that gets disrupted, you're going to have downstream impacts. If the Himalayas cease to have the ice or begin to reduce in its amount, you're already seeing water impacts. Rivers are going to start to dry up. Billions of people rely on those rivers for food in parts of the world. The Mekong, the Yellow River, the Yangtze, the Ganges. These rivers are all sourced in places that rely on the ice sheet, the melt, the snow. As that changes, you could have profound impacts. This is not conjectural. It's already happening in certain places. There are climate refugees today, just not yet in the millions, depending on. But if you have a complete collapse in a region, Those people are going to be knocking on the door of a place that is livable. And they will be prepared. We've already had wars over water. You have fights over water. Conflict as the water becomes more of a problem. Our own reservoir, the Ogallala Reservoir, which is the principal reservoir of the United States of America, has challenges. Go to the four corners of Nevada and Colorado, et cetera, and find out how development is already being impacted by the lack of water. So there are major challenges going forward as the world's climate changes, and where we can produce and what we produce also shifts with it. There are other potential conflicts. We saw in Syria about 1 million people come out of the desert into the Damascus area because there was a drought of several years. And that had a profound impact on the politics of the region. And it became part of the dynamics of what went on with Assad and Daesh and the exploitation of people as a consequence of their shifted locale and lack of integration to that particular new locale. On the subject of methane, methane is 20 to 80 plus times more damaging than CO2.
Gentleman's time has expired. I now recognize Representative Dara Issa of California for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good to have you back, Mr. Secretary. During the 2 years that I was out of Congress, and similarly you were not currently in government, I was involved with the Trade Development Agency, which is established to basically export, if you will, infrastructure around the world. It has a mandate that includes virtually all of Africa, much of South America, and much of Asia. That organization competes directly with the Belt and Road initiative of the Chinese, but with less than 2% as much money as they operate on. Isn't it fair to say that if what we want to do is enable developing nations, including those in Africa, to reduce their carbon footprint as they grow their economy, we're going to have to be the country that delivers that type of infrastructure, because China certainly is not doing that today?
China is not delivering that kind of infrastructure today. We need to, I think, be in the game, and we need to help deliver it, but not alone. There are plenty of countries that know how to do it and will do it well that are engaged.
And we do partner with Japan and other countries, and I'm glad to see us doing that because we are, of course, delivering a smaller footprint. You mentioned that China produces 73% of, if you will, the renewable assets, wind and solar. If they had used it themselves rather than building those coal-fired plants, would they have gone up or down likely in their CO2 emissions?
They actually are using it themselves, Congressman. They are the largest. They have the largest deployment of renewable of anybody else in the world.
But they also use twice as much coal as we do and continue to grow.
That is correct.
As we look at a number of countries, I want to quickly go to India. During the last administration, India negotiated numerous times to acquire LNG capability and convert some of their coal-fired plants, future coal-fired plants, to natural gas. At the end of the day, they reneged and didn't buy anything. Isn't it true that part of the challenge you face with India and China is the attitude, we can't afford to be clean, and that is one of the reasons both of those countries will continue to peak up in CO2 emissions while the United States has been dropping for more than a decade?
I would say to you, sir, with all respect, that it's there is an attitude, but that's not it. The attitude is we're less developed countries, and we have to still develop, and according to the original Paris standard, there is a thing called common but differentiated responsibility. So we have.
I appreciate that, Mr. Secretary, and I think you're exactly right. There's two different ways to say the same thing. We're not developed enough. We're not rich enough. But at the end of the day, they believe they have a right to continue producing more CO2 in order to catch up with our economies.
They do.
Well, we do it down. So domestically, for a moment, isn't it true that we're going to have to find ways to reduce our carbon footprint, well, in fact, not putting ourselves at a competitive disadvantage to our competitors around the world who are using lower cost energy, lower currently than most renewables?
Yes.
So if we're to do that, wouldn't the Biden administration have to continue a trajectory that began with the Bush administration and continued through the last two administrations, which is to convert from coal to natural gas, to increase efficiencies, to use all of the above, and to ladder our way down in the consumption or production of CO2 rather than a draconian one? And I want to follow up with one quick question. You said, you quoted, I think, the LA Times, when you said that California had 95% renewable at one point on one day. Oddly enough, my district in Southern California has had repeated blackouts as a result of having not enough energy, because on a hot afternoon, when the sun starts going down, we run out of power. So isn't all of the above and a blended solution what the United States should do, while at the same time laddering down our CO2 emissions?
Well, the key, I think, Congressman, is to do it in a way that is integrated so that you can not have any of those challenges. Now, this was one day, and I think they were pushing the curve to try to find out what happened. It's obviously not a long-term system.
But the blackouts were many days.
No, I get it. But that's why we need to have a smart approach that is integrated, but at the same time, gas is a challenge.
Gentleman's time has expired.
Maybe we'll have more time so we can follow up.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
Gentleman's time has expired. I now acknowledge Representative Joaquin Castro of Texas, who's the chair of the Subcommittee on International Development, International Organizations, and Global Corporate Social Impact, for 5 minutes.
Secretary Kerry, great to see you again. Thank you for joining us today. And climate change is an existential threat that the United States must lead on, and your appointment is a welcome sign. Most of the work of the Paris Agreement and our efforts to strengthen the agreement focus on controlling carbon emissions. And this is critical, but I want to ask you about what we're also doing to address the effects of climate change, which are already occurring. Current laws on refugees and international migration are not well suited to address the needs of people displaced by climate. And the effects of climate change on crops and livelihood have contributed to migration in Central America, the Middle East, and West Africa. And I know in response to Mr. Cicilline's question, you touched upon this, but I wanted to ask you, does the United States and other countries that have disproportionately emitted carbon have a responsibility to take in those displaced by climate change?
I think commensurate with our overall immigration goals and targets, they have to be included. It's not an automatic license that you're going to be able to take everybody, obviously, but within our appropriate limits, we have to. But I think the more important thing, frankly, Congressman, is, you know, rather than wait for these effects to hit us the way we do, I mean, for the spending, for instance, of the $265 billion I talked in my opening comments about 22 separate events last year, a record, all of which required $1 billion of expenditure. If we don't start to think ahead and apply some vision to our making of policy, we're going to wind up paying, and not getting any real consequence for it. We've got to start investing in the future now, and that's the theory of what President Biden has put on the table. Invest. It's not just an expenditure. It's an investment. And if we do that, then we have an ability to get to the root causes, the root challenge for why people are moving and why this pressure is growing. Otherwise, it's going to be like a fire hose,
sure,
constantly coming at you.
And just to follow up to that, I have two questions that I'll put together. What will the Biden administration do to update and strengthen international rules for resettling people displaced by climate change? And do you support amending U.S. law and conventions at the United Nations to include climate refugees?
I do believe we have to have a formal acceptance of the concept of climate refugees. Yes, I do. I don't have an answer to the first part of your question. I'd have to get that from those folks in the administration working on that.
No. Thank you very much. I yield back, Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. I now recognize Representative Ann Wagner of Missouri, who is the vice-ranking member of the full committee, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Kerry, on April 25th, the New York Times published Iranian Foreign Minister Mohammad Javad Zarif's claim that you, as Secretary of State, revealed classified information regarding Israel's covert attacks on Iranian interests in Syria. These allegations are extremely disturbing. Iran poses an existential threat to Israel, a key U.S. ally, and it has repeatedly demonstrated its willingness to attack Israel directly, both through proxies and from its position in Syria. Given the gravity of the security threat Iran poses to the U.S. and allied interests, I believe the report should be investigated in full. If true, Javad Zarif's claims raise serious questions regarding your ability, sir, to unreservedly protect U.S. interests as Special Presidential Envoy for Climate. The degree and the nature of U.S. participation in international climate change agreement must, and I underscore, must be informed by our national security interests. An overly narrow focus on left-wing action items like the deeply flawed Paris Agreement and the Iran nuclear deal cannot blind us to the malign intentions of adversaries like Iran, Russia, and the People's Republic of China. On April 28th, I sent a letter, this letter, to the Acting Inspector General of the Department of State and to the Secretary of State, requesting an investigation into your relationship with Iran's foreign minister. Are you aware of this letter, sir?
No, I'm not.
I'll make sure you have a copy.
Well, obviously I'm aware of it now.
The letter also requested a response to several very specific questions by today, May 12th. As I have not received answers, and Mr. Chairman, I'd like this entered into the record. I'd like to ask you now, what were the circumstances surrounding your alleged leak of information to Javad Zarif, including the timing of this conversation? What role have you had in formulating U.S. policy on re-entering the Iran nuclear deal, sir?
Well, I think your premise is incorrect. The story did not allege that I transferred classified information. It didn't even characterize it as classified. It simply said that on a tape, Javad was overheard in a long, long lamentation about how he was out of the loop in Iran and in the policy, and how he had learned this and learned that from somebody, and then popped in saying—
He said he learned it from you, sir, and that you told him there were 200 instances.
He said he learned one thing from me, and I have already answered that question. I never said that. I don't know how he came up with that. Don't know where it came from, and it was not— there was nothing stated in there about my having released anything on classified information. And in 28 years in the United States Senate, and in 6 years on the Intel Committee, and as chair of the Foreign Relations Committee, and as Secretary of State in 4 years, never has anybody suggested I did not protect classified
Well, I would like a full investigation, and I would like my questions answered. I'll see if you have a copy. The Biden administration seems to be copying the same climate rhetoric and policies as California, but California has some of the highest electricity prices in the country, is the largest importer of energy, and rolling blackouts are not uncommon. In fact, the state has been sued by civil rights groups for the impact of their climate policies on low income and communities of color. And to top it off, according to the Department of Energy, California performance since 2010 in reducing energy-related carbon emissions ranked 43rd among all states. What is your opinion of the California approach, and do you think it is a model for the rest of the country, sir?
I think California has done an incredible job of pushing the curve, of trying—
43rd, ranked 43rd in the country.
In 43rd in what?
among all states in reducing energy-related carbon emissions. And they're doing a great job.
The gentlelady's time has expired. I now recognize Representative Dina Titus of Nevada for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Secretary Kerry, for being with us today. We certainly appreciate your efforts in this area and commend you for the work that you're doing. We've heard a lot about the major focus of COP21 and the Paris Agreement being on reducing global emissions. And that's all great, but it seems to put us in the position of working from behind. Could you address some of the things that we need to do to be proactive around the world so we can meet long-term gains, not just clean up the mess that exists, but make the future better?
Well, I think the single most important thing that we need to do, we are doing, which is the United States of America under President Biden has put forward an extremely thoughtful, achievable, and aggressive reductions level so that we're leading by example, which the President has talked about a great deal. So we are going to be striving for, over the next 10 years, a 50 to 52% reduction in our emissions. I will tell you that that has really helped us to come back to the table with credibility on an international basis. Now, I emphasize, no one nation can solve this problem. I mean, we can sit here and lament, we can, you know, be talking about America's preeminence in one sector or another. But the truth is that there are 89% of the global emissions coming from other countries, and 20 countries are responsible for about 73% of all emissions. So if the 20 countries, this was the theory of our summit, we brought those 20 countries together, the majority of them have stepped up and are stepping up with new reduction targets. But we need other countries to do that. So what the United States is trying to do now, under President Biden's leadership, is to reach out to those countries and work with them. We have a working group that is literally sitting with these nations and trying to articulate to them in a thoughtful and respectful way how they might be able to transition faster off of some coal, or how they may be able to implement and deploy more renewables faster. And it's only by that kind of help from the developed world that we have a prayer of winning this battle. So the key here is for the U.S. to be on target. The second thing we need to do, which is exciting, I mean, we're looking at the biggest transitional opportunity since the Industrial Revolution. The United States of America doesn't even have a grid yet, folks. We don't have a grid. We can go to the moon, but we can't send an electron from one part of the country to another. We've got to build the transmission capacity. We've got to use AI, quantum computing, be able to instantaneously, I mean, the Congresswoman talked about where California is. If we could send California clean energy, windmill or wind power or solar or Nevada or any other place to somewhere else in the country at a given time, with our time difference of 3 hours and with battery storage at utility scale that already gets 4 hours, you could begin to really manage a system as you wait for daylight and as you wait for the wind. So this could be managed, and artificial intelligence and quantum computing give us a huge advantage in our ability to do that. So that's the way we can help lead the world. We should be leading on all of these technologies. Historically, that's what's made America so strong. Now we have to get back into that race. And I think we're looking at huge opportunities of providing hydrogen and storage, and perhaps even on this other front, fourth generation, next modular nuclear, who knows what it's going to be. I'm for an all of the above effort, because we don't know which of the best of these technologies is yet going to work to do what we have to do. One last word. Even if we get to net zero by 2050, we are still going to have to suck carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. A lot of people don't stop thinking that. We still need the technology that's going to enable us to do it. So I think there are great possibilities here for discovery. We're creating more jobs in this sector already in America. And as I mentioned in the beginning, there are already more people working in this new clean energy sector than there are working in fossil fuel or in many other sectors.
Gentlelady's time has expired. I now acknowledge Representative Brian Mast of Florida for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, you just quite literally contradicted yourself. You said you are for all of the above, but you're not. We spoke earlier, Representative Issa asked the question about the Keystone Pipeline. You're fundamentally in disagreement with delivering that fuel into the United States of America. It would beg the question, did the hack on the Colonial Pipeline save you the trouble of having to shut that one down?
Well, Congressman, I appreciate your question. And may I, as a matter of personal privilege, just say how much I admire your personal service to our country.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
I would say to you this. I don't think it's a contradiction. Yes, we're going to use gas for some period of time. And I'm not one of those that comes in and says, you got to shut it down today, tomorrow. We can't do that. What we can do is begin to take steps that reduce reliance, even as we keep alive the ability to have sufficient gas for the purposes we need.
It's a fair point, Mr. Secretary. But to the point that you made to my friend, Mr. Issa, to quote it, that is true. The pipelines are more carbon delivery efficient than rails and trucks.
Correct.
Saying they deliver the fuel by using less carbon in order to deliver that fuel. Let me finish the quote.
Let me finish the quote
and I'll let you respond.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean that you want to be adding another line, another one of these more efficient routes. There are alternatives, but yes, pipeline is better than trains and trucks.
So let me tell you why we can do better in meeting our goal of reducing our emissions. All the gas we burn, first of all, gas is 87% methane. Gas leaks. If you in the Permian Basin, for instance, we have a leakage, even if you have it around 2.7%, scientists say that can be more damaging than CO2. Our leakage is at about 5% or 10% in some places in America. Now, if that's the leakage in America, think what it is in other places. Because of the melting of permafrost and the melting of the tundra, the thawing of the tundra, we're now seeing methane being released around the world that isn't capped, that isn't used. President Biden has put an effort into his legislation to start capping open wells and open mines that are giving off methane in the United States.
Mr. Secretary, could I summarize your position by saying you want no crude or petrol used? Would that be an accurate summary?
The what?
You want no crude, no petrol used in the future. Would that be an accurate summary?
Well, it depends what you mean by the future. We're going to be doing that. We're going to be using crude. Crude, first of all, is used for lots of other things than fuel and power. So we're going to use crude well into the future.
Not delivered by pipeline, though.
Well, no, it could well be delivered by pipeline already. We're doing that. But our source of power, President Biden has already made this decision, and the utilities are already accepting it.
I want to ask one more question because I want to yield some time to one of my friends here who may not be able to ask you some questions.
By 2035, though, President Biden is determined we will be carbon-free in our power production.
You're talking about not allowing these new avenues to deliver them, even though they're more efficient, like the Keystone Pipeline. Would there also be an effort to not promote other forms of delivery, that is to say, not permit a new rail car that's being used to deliver that because Colonial is down right now, not permitting a new truck to go over the road, which is what's being used to deliver those fuels right now. Would that also be a part of the program?
No, I don't. I really think we're talking much more reasonably, Congressman, in a way that we have to try to accelerate the transition to clean fuel. That's what we have to try to accelerate. It's not going to happen overnight. So we're going to need, now, I'd rather see gas used rather than coal anywhere in the world. And I think there are ways to try to assist in doing that. But even gas.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I'm going to yield my time to Mr. Pfluger for a moment.
Okay. No, thank you for yielding. Mr. Secretary, for the first time in 70 years, our country is energy independent. It's a lever of power. It's national security. Energy security is national security. And so you've mentioned that we need to take steps. We have taken steps, as you've clearly highlighted today, from being 15% down to 11%. That's huge. Do you believe that wind and solar can provide baseload capacity for this country?
Not alone.
No, that's absolutely right. We saw it in Texas, the winter storms, and we've seen it in California.
I should amend that by saying, Congressman, not yet alone. If we break through on storage.
Gentlemen's time has expired.
The answer is yes.
I now recognize Representative Susan Wild of Pennsylvania for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Secretary Kerry, thank you for your lifelong service to our country and for appearing before our committee today. I want to switch gears a little bit and talk about the Amazon rainforest, which has often been referred to as the lungs of the earth because of its crucial role in sustaining human life and biodiversity across the globe. But unfortunately, under the Bolsonaro government in Brazil, as I'm sure you're aware, deforestation has surged to record highs as the government has rolled back environmental protection mechanisms and emboldened those who are engaged in illegal logging and mining. We saw the culmination of these actions in the catastrophic mass-scale fires in the Brazilian Amazon in 2019, just as we see unchecked deforestation contributing to the climate crisis for our entire planet today. President Biden has expressed interest in attempting to negotiate an agreement to protect the Brazilian Amazon, clearly an imperative for combating climate change. And I was wondering if you could update us on the status of those negotiations and address the issue of verification mechanisms.
Well, we're in the midst of that negotiation now. We've just started it really a few weeks ago. We've had some positive conversations, and we're hopeful that we can translate intent into action that will wind up being effective and verifiable. Obviously, there have been challenges in that, and we're very aware of those challenges. The fact, as I mentioned earlier, that the Amazon was doing relatively well up until, I think, around 2012, and then suddenly took a surge up in the amount of cutting that took place and the land grabbing that took place. We've got to create, the imperative here is to create a verifiable enforcement structure that everybody has confidence in. That's the goal, and that's what we're working towards, and if we can get there, you know, it may be possible to have an agreement that works for everybody. I mean, the truth is, there is a value in the Amazon that a country, Brazil, looks at and says, well, maybe we don't accept the theory of this, we want to do it this way. And there are assets within there, not to mention the great asset of indigenous people who live there and who need to be significantly taken into account with regard to their future. So all of those are the equities. Those are the equities.
I'm going to ask you to stop right there because you just touched on something that I wanted to ask about, and that is the role of the indigenous communities in the negotiations and any subsequent agreement. Can we assume that they will be included? Has the administration been consulting with local indigenous leaders at all?
We're certainly consulting with representatives thereof. None of us have been down there or had any personal meetings at this point in time. But the answer is their concerns are paramount, and they have a huge voice in this, and they need to be heard.
And you agree then that the protection of indigenous communities has to be one of the paramount concerns?
Everywhere. Wherever we are engaged in this, President Biden is super focused and targeted on justice, on fairness, and on a process that is sensitive where sometimes in the past it hasn't been.
So let me just switch gears with just over a minute left. The EU has approved the principle of imposing basically a carbon tariff on imports from countries that don't price or tax carbon, and is expected to design a directive to attempt to implement this policy. You know, those of us in districts like mine with a very intensive manufacturing sector as part of our local economy are strongly committed to protecting the interests of our workers and businesses as well. But my question is, since your comments on this, that this policy should be a last resort, could you update us on the status of this issue with the Europeans?
I didn't hear the original piece, of which issue?
Of the carbon tariff that the EU is intending to impose.
They're calling it a border adjustment mechanism. They are looking right now at exactly how it would work in order not to be disruptive, but at the same time to be effective. I honestly don't have an answer to that at this point in time. We're looking at it. President Biden has instructed us to understand it and to thoroughly vet whatever the impacts might be, and that's what we're going to do.
Gentlelady's time has expired.
Thank you very much.
I now recognize Representative Brian Fitzpatrick of Pennsylvania, who's the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Europe, Energy, Environment, and Cyber, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary Kerry, thank you for being here with us today. According to a recent report by the Rhodium Group, China emits close to 30% of global emissions. China's share of global emissions has grown to more than all the OECD nations combined. In fact, today, by comparison, the United States emissions are 1 billion tons less than they were in 2005, and our trajectory is going down, while Chinese emissions are well over 4 billion tons higher than they were in 2005, and their trajectory is going up. So a couple of questions. First, is this dramatic increase in emissions consistent with China's Paris Accord pledge? And number two, what are the effective accountability mechanisms in place to certify that countries like the PRC are following through on their climate commitments?
I didn't hear the very last part of it, but the simple answer is no, the current level and rate of reduction is not consistent with the pledge, as it is not, I might add, for quite a few countries. There just are too many countries not yet in compliance, and that will be one of the major, that's why we, President Biden summoned the climate summit he held, is precisely to get people focused on a raising of ambition. And that will be our goal over the course of these next 5 months. So you can't look at this as where we are today. We've got to look at it as where we could be in the next, you know, as we get into September, October, and head to Glasgow.
Understood, sir. But obviously, China's been in the center of a lot of different issues from an intelligence standpoint, a foreign affairs standpoint, economic.
For sure. No question.
And there have been a lot of troubling comments coming out of the PRC regarding their plans to basically exploit the parameters of Paris. By amping up, rather than reducing as we approach that date, amping up their coal production, their carbon emissions, almost making a mockery out of the whole intent of Paris. So I was just curious as to what your thoughts are, as it pertains to China and their good faith as far as their good faith commitments or the level of good faith they have in their commitments to Paris.
Well, let me speak to that this way. I've said to you, I agree that there are big challenges. There are major issues that we have with China. My focus is obviously to deal with the climate crisis and to get us hopefully in a place where it's constructive and we're moving in the right direction. So with respect to that, we need obviously to get greater cooperation from China. We're talking about that now. That is on the table as a critical component. Now, China believes that they're doing a certain amount. I know they know that they are seized by the issue of having to do greater reductions. We're hopeful we can get China in a place where we respect the common but differentiated, so that China is doing not exactly what we're doing, but China is doing enough that it is clear they are seriously reducing and they are making their best effort to hold the 1.5 degrees. And if we can get into a place where that's actually happening and we have the ability to know it's happening and trace it, then we'll have advanced this ball. We're not there yet, and we've got a lot of work to do to try to get there. One other thing I will say to you is, one of the new benefits of technology is that we have an ability through space and satellite tracking to now measure quite precisely what a particular company is doing, or whether its food, its supply chain is behaving the way they promised. And we can look even at governments and whole countries and have almost real-time readout on exactly what is happening with respect to their emissions. So the planet will have much greater transparency and accountability than it's ever had as a result of technology's assist here.
One last question, sir. What should the consequences be to China if they are proceeding in bad faith, and we determine that to be the case?
Well, I mean, one of the obviously already raised by several members is the challenge of the border adjustment mechanism and the possibility of some kind of tariff. That's out there. And, you know, I think, and China's not the only country affected. By the way, every country would be subject to that. So we, too, would have to make sure we're in alignment and subject to it. So we're examining exactly how it might work, how it could be fair. For the moment, we'd like to not.
Gentlemen's time has expired. I now recognize Representative Dean Phillips of Minnesota for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And as a Gold Star son who lost his father in Vietnam, I want to thank you, Mr. Secretary, for your sacrifices there and for your service as a senator, Secretary of State, and of course now in this capacity. And I have to say, I am saddened that some of my colleagues would seemingly put the faith in the word of the Iranian foreign minister over that of yours. I'm sorry for that. The irony is not lost on me. My questions are about climate change, and you're aware of President Biden's interest in what he calls foreign policy for the middle class. And with that in mind, I would love it if you would speak for a few moments about how you and the administration are approaching decarbonization of our economy while also mitigating the incremental costs to American families that might result from that transition.
That's a great question, Congressman, and thank you for your personal comments. I appreciate it. And wish life had been otherwise for you. With respect to decarbonization and foreign policy for families, the president, and I think this is where this gets exciting, is convinced, as I am, that the opportunities here are so much greater than any deficit in this transformation. We have transitioned historically many times. The Industrial Revolution was a transition. When the steam engine came on and the cotton gin, and life changed and great communities were built. Bill Keating, Representative Keating and I understand how Massachusetts was changed by that, and Rhode Island and other states, textile industry, shoe industry, and so on. Then it moved. But other things came and replaced it. Our economy still remains strong in America despite these transitions. And we grow stronger and we build out a larger middle class. I think that's going to happen here in amazing ways. I mean, already you're seeing there's a prediction by the Labor Bureau statistics that there are three jobs that are going to grow more than 50% this next year. One, the number one, is wind turbine technician. That's at 62% growth. The second job is nurse practitioner. We all know why that's growing, unfortunately. The third is solar panel installer, which is going to grow at about 51%. Now, what we see is, as in vehicles, I just talked the other day with the senator from South Carolina. We were talking about the transition in South Carolina and how, you know, folks who are making an internal combustion engine car now are going to not only be making an electric vehicle, but they're going to be growing the number of plants that are there, and the job opportunities are going to grow. I think if you look at what's already happening in the early clean tech markets of solar, wind, batteries, there are dozens of emerging clean tech markets here in the United States that are going to enlarge economic opportunity for people. And people are earning, without a high school degree, in some of these early jobs, $24 an hour, which, as we know, is more than double the the minimum wage. Yeah. So,
yeah, sir, and I'd like to reclaim some time. I do want to call attention to those effects and ensure that we do look after those who will suffer from incremental costs. I want to talk about pipelines too. As you well know, the State Department manages presidential permits for cross-border pipelines. In my home state of Minnesota, Enbridge is currently replacing over 330 miles of its Line 3 crude oil pipeline that runs from Alberta across the border all the way to Wisconsin. It's a pipeline that's older than me, first used in 1968 before the National Environmental Policy Act was enacted in 1970. So there are serious concerns about the lack of environmental reviews on the project. In fact, when Enbridge sought to replace Line 3 in 2014, the State Department determined that it did not require a new permit, as you're probably aware. So how are you and the Biden administration approaching decisions on cross-border pipeline construction, replacement, and upgrades? And have you spoken with Minister Wilkinson?
I confess to you, I have not had that conversation at this point in time. And so I would rather get you an answer, but have it be informed.
Okay. All right, well, I see my time is unfortunately.
So what we'll do is we'll come back to you with that.
I'd welcome that. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
The last question will be from Representative Tim Burchett of Tennessee. You're now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before we go into this, I wanted to call your attention to some legislation. My colleague Bruce Resterman from Arkansas, he's an Ivy Leaguer like you, but he sounds more country than me. He's from Arkansas. He has some legislation called the Trillion Trees Initiative. And that is the ultimate sequester of carbon, and I would appreciate you looking at that after you finish with your note. I appreciate that, brother, if you could have one of your staffers, if they would. It's truly a good piece of legislation. How do we trust the Chinese Communist Party to do anything they say they're going to do with their increased coal power capacity and everything else that they're doing and their violations of human rights in the world?
Congressman, we will take a look at that legislation. And secondly, as I've said several times here, it's not a matter of taking things by trust. We have to have a mechanism where we're both measuring, where we're accountable to each other, where we're actually able to know what is happening. And it'd be stupid and malpractice if we just sort of set up a kind of trust thing.
Okay, I know that we did that with the Iranians, and I don't want to gig you, but it seems like we kind of got it handed to us on that deal, and I would just hope that we could follow through with that.
Well, also, we didn't, in all fairness, we didn't pull out of that deal. I mean,
you can't trust them to do anything. They're the leading proponents of terrorism in the world. More American blood on their hands than anybody in the last 20 years, probably.
I understand all of that, which is why we put in place the most severe, most extensive, singularly most accountable verification system ever put into any nuclear agreement.
Okay.
And that was there until the former president pulled out.
And I appreciate that. I'm not trying to gig you, but I want to know a straight answer. Why does your office position even exist, given that the State Department already has an entire bureau devoted to oceans and international environment and scientific affairs, another devoted to energy resources, and that has ensured that their climate policy will be a priority in every bureau, office, and post?
That's a very fair question. And the answer is because we're in such a crisis globally, and because President Biden wanted to find somebody who was experienced and had credibility within this arena to try to raise the profile of his efforts and accelerate our movement. President Biden came in on January 20th. We have probably one of the most important negotiations we've ever engaged in globally on November 1st of this year.
Thank you,
so
brother.
So he wanted to accelerate it.
And I want to appreciate you on your Purple Hearts. My dad said that's the only medal he's glad he never got in the Pacific. So thank you, brother. And I want to yield 2 minutes to my good friend Andy Barr, if that's possible, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for being here.
I thank my friend from Tennessee and Envoy Kerry. In your current role, you've said that your goal is to, quote, change the allocation of capital with respect to fossil energy. Press reports suggest you've pressured major U.S. financial institutions to align their lending practices with the administration's climate goals. In your response to my letter on this issue, you said there was no pressure. I'm the ranking member of the Financial Services Oversight and Investigation Subcommittee. The CEOs of the six largest U.S. banks will be testifying in my committee on May 27th. I plan to ask them about this. Of those six banks, my understanding is that three have joined your efforts and three did not. Did any of these bank CEOs or their representatives receive a term sheet for the commitments required to be part of the Net Zero Banking Alliance? And did you provide them with a term sheet?
I didn't create the Net Zero Alliance. That was created.
No, I understand, but the press.
Well, I don't know what they're. That's Mark Carney, who was the former governor of the Bank of England, and he put the alliance together with some other people. These other banks joined it. They joined it without any discussion.
I understand. Reclaiming my time, though, after the alliance, and regardless of what the Bank of England did, your office, either you or any representatives of your office, did you, in your efforts to promote the climate finance agenda of the administration, provide a term sheet to any of the banks?
No.
If not, if the banks are changing their allocation of capital on a voluntary basis, why are you even engaging with these institutions?
What happened is, just to give you directly, one of the banks actually reached out to me. They came to me and said, we believe it would be a great public thing if we were to allocate a certain amount of funding, and they had a very significant amount, to climate-related investment. And I said, whoa, that's fantastic. I think it's great. Yeah. And other banks who I knew were already engaged in some of this.
My time has expired, but the fact that some of has abstained.
Gentlemen's time has expired.
They have felt pressure from your
gentlemen's time
all
has
we
expired.
Did, all
gentlemen's
we did
time has expired. So let me thank and all of that concludes all of the questioning for today as we hit our hard stop.
Mr. Chairman, I'm happy to take some questions for the record. If people wanted to put something in, I'm happy to do that.
Mr. Chairman, I have a point of parliamentary inquiry.
Go ahead.
We have a five-minute rule in this committee and in Congress, and Mr. Levin, Mrs. Houlihan, Mr. Malinowski, Ms. Jacobs, Manning, Costa, Vargas are all Democrats that were denied their ability under the five-minute rule to ask questions today. On the Republican side, Mr. Green, Mr. Barr got yielded time but didn't get his full 5 minutes. Myself, Mr. Muser, Ms. Tinney, Mr. Pfluger got yielded a minute but was denied otherwise his 5 minutes. Ms. Maliotakis, Mr. Meyer, Jackson and Kim were all denied their ability under the five-minute rule to question former Secretary, the envoy. Also, we were also cut off under Secretary Blinken. By the time they got to me, we only had 3 minutes. This committee has subpoena authority, so my question and my inquiry would be, when we're bringing members from the administration, all of those members that I just named all got denied their ability to represent their districts and ask Mr. Kerry questions because he has to leave and do other things. So I don't understand why members of the administration don't feel like it's appropriate to schedule their time when you've requested them to come and come to this hearing and give opportunity to only, I don't know what the number is, but half of the members of this committee to ask questions. So I would ask moving forward, is it the chair's intention to, one, when we bring members of the administration here, that they're gonna be here for ample time, to not be denied the 5 minute rule under the rules of this committee and this Congress, to have their ability to ask questions?
Yeah, it's been the tradition of this committee, and we will continue where we get the administration here under any administration, whether it was this administration, the prior administration, since the time that I've been here, that members from the administration comes and gives us, and we accept the time limits of which we have. Generally, we have, sometimes there's unlimited time, other times, as today, we knew that there was a hard stop at 12:30.
Was that
one of the reasons why I was strict on the time was to get as many members to testify, to ask their questions as possible.
Well, we weren't told, as a member of this committee, we weren't told ahead of time that he was leaving at 12:30.
Well, it happened
Congressman,
prior administration.
I will be happy to make an appointment with you, come up, sit down and chat with you. You get more than 5 minutes. If you want to have a talk, I'm happy to do it.
Well, I think it's important to do it in front of the American people so that they get to hear your responses
Let me just come back. And I'm sure that the secretary will have ample opportunity to come back at that time, and maybe we'll start then from the bottom of the row and come up. So in trying to be in all fairness another time. So that's, I understand your frustration, particularly all of us used to be down at the bottom of the line at one point. That is not taking place, so that's the tradition that's happened here in the United States House of Representatives. 30 seconds to close. I know he's got to go. Go ahead.
Well, Secretary, thanks for being here. And just let me say, I think, Chairman, you heard from my side and your side that China is going to be paramount in the success of your negotiations. And good luck catching your flight, sir.
Let me thank the witnesses. I know he has to catch a commercial flight headed over to Europe. But I want to close the record by saying that climate change is no longer a crisis on the horizon. It is an existential threat that will displace populations, imperil economies, fuel conflict, and forever change our planet. America cannot single-handedly overcome climate change alone, but we can, however, lead the international community into collective action. My first trip as a member of Congress 23 years ago was not anywhere abroad, but far away to Alaska. And me, a boy from Queens, more accustomed to riding the subways of New York, took three flights on even smaller planes to learn about the environment, energy, the Arctic, and our beautiful country. It changed my life and connected issues in Queens to Anchorage. And while showing me that what will cost our children and our grandchildren, I have two, if we do not act. We have a duty to be responsible stewards of our environment, and which is God's gift to us. And I say this as chairman of this committee, I am immensely proud of the seriousness with which the new administration has approached this challenge, and I want to thank Special Envoy Kerry for his expert testimony today on the path ahead. We are in good hands with his leadership and the leadership of President Joe Biden, but I also want to thank Ranking Member McCall for his partnership with me, as always, on conducting in the manner we move this hearing and this committee together. I really thank you and appreciate you for your service, sir. And I want to thank all of the members of the Foreign Affairs Committee for their participation today. And with that, this hearing is now adjourned.